28th UMA trade fair starts despite low spending power amongst Ugandans. Afreximbank launches Africa's first academy to train business community. New MTN CEO takes over office. Tanzania UAE sign trade deal to improve double taxation. And Ethiopia raises fuel prices by 20%. Hello there, and thank you for joining us on The Business Show this week. My name is Simon. So much happening in the world of business. It is October already, and so it's about 2 months now, and 2022 will be done. For a business person, counting on the goals set at the start of the year is probably what you can hope you are on track about or for. And if some things are not working out, then you probably just have to start thinking of what can be done to improve the circumstances. Okay, we have a lot lined up for you on The Business Show this week, so let's just show you what's coming up.
In an area that has never had a marketplace concept before, and we believe that this addresses the scalability challenges that have been faced in many African markets.
Once again, welcome to the show. And we think that despite all the challenges that are happening in the country and generally with the different regions and the continent, there's just so much that is happening. The experts are seated somewhere and looking through and saying, look, all this that we're trying to develop should be able to support businesses. Products that are being tailored should be solution-oriented. We're talking about the fact that everything, whether it is from the banking sector to insurance, they should be offering a timely solution to support businesses to recovery. Of course, we know that after COVID-19, just when we thought we were settling in, then the Ukraine-Russian crisis stepped in. But we'll just wait to see how much more can be done to support businesses. Let's get this started then. And last week we did an episode of M-Circle. Now, this is a product by FeatureLink, which seeks to not just empower the locals serving with circles, but also boosting the general aspect of financial inclusion. And we did see how, in the first episode, a bigger number of people now is shifting towards the direction, not just saving in circles and that's all, but saving, borrowing at a lower interest. This week, we want to continue with that conversation with the CEO of FeatureLink, and we're discussing a recent Global SME Platform Award for Product Innovation of the Year. Now, this product, they are the first to win it in the African continent. That and more on how this product will help the industry is what we now seek to understand in our part two of Views from the Top with the CEO of FeatureLink.
FinTechs are a very welcome innovation. To the extent that we shall address these two areas, that we are community responsive, that we shall not design a product from Kampala in some boardroom and then push it down to the communities of farmers. That will not work. And two, that we are cognizant of the affordability element in the services that we roll out. Because it's going to be difficult if services, yes, people can access them, but they cannot afford them. And that is also the other element. In this country, you still have people borrowing at 10% per month. That's 120% per year. There is very little chance that you will succeed. And people need to understand that if you are borrowing at 10% per month, It's very difficult. Please, I urge you, don't borrow that money. Don't take that money. It's going to be a problem. It's going to be a problem. And amazingly, there are some fintechs that are facilitating that kind of lending. That is irresponsible lending. And we feel that in our service, we should not really be mercenaries who just make money and leave. Because at the end of the day, every mercenary in business will be discovered. If you are doing something that you feel is paying you more than you should earn right now, it's just a matter of time and you will be discovered. And the pains, the cost is really, really huge. So I appeal to, you know, other fintechs out there, let's really serve the people. Let's serve the people. Don't facilitate borrowing at 10% per month. The only business that you can do with such money is also to lend to someone else. And that is really not. So it's really amazing. The Global SME Finance, Platinum Award. This is the only one, the very only kind of award this year. We were crowned as the Global SME Finance Platinum Awardee Product Innovation of the Year. And I had an opportunity to look at, you know, the comments, some of the judges that were generous to give us the comments, and these are some of the comments. You guys are doing something that introduces a new way of accessing financial services in an area that has never had a marketplace concept before. And we believe that this addresses the scalability challenges that have been faced in many African markets. What they meant was that the generic product, having one generic product, pushing it onto many African countries will not work. You know, Africa is very different. If you look at India, look at China, look at US, these are big economies with big, you know, markets. And the impression is that you can have one product that is going to work for many millions, but that is not going to work in Africa. So Africa needs community responsive products. And we are happy that the IFC World Bank, together with the SME Finance Forum, has validated our model that we need to involve the communities in the design and delivery and the pricing of the services we say should work for them. We need to give them the voice. And we are really happy. This, you know, these awards are competed for by leading banks in the world. And we are happy that we were selected as the winners of the Product Innovation of the Year 2022. You know, setting aside the banks, the fintechs in the world, and we believe that this is now having our model been validated. Now it's day one. It's the beginning of a very important journey. It has been a journey of discovery. It has been a journey of listening. When we started out some time back, it was very difficult. Even people were not willing to actually register. They thought that was a way to steal their money. There were communities where we also found out, for example, that some people with some religious beliefs don't use mobile money. Yes, in this country. They're not allowed to use mobile money. And then you have also other challenges where women don't own phones. Some women don't own phones. The husbands, the ones who own phones, very, very unfortunate. But we have seen that trend improve. But let me also mention that one of the things that we have been able to realize was the unique impact that MSACO is having on gender violence within the communities. We found out, for example, that women feared to appear at the banking hall because the husbands, seeing them at the banking hall, suddenly know that they have money. So they usually kept the money in, at home, under the mattress, or lend it to their friends, their relatives. When we gave them mobile MSACO, now they are able to save. There is a particular woman who told me, you know, her story. She could only save once. She would keep it, accumulate it. But accumulation of money is also difficult, you know. You will then get a relative who wants to borrow. You get some other expenditure. So it was often difficult. But she would try to accumulate it and then take it to her circle at the end of the month. Now she's able to actually save 5 days, five times a week. And her savings have been able to go up by about five times. And she's able to access credit she's able to access manure to put in her banana plantation, which she could not do previously. So it has reduced gender violence that often comes from people fighting for money, husband beating the wife, you know, to surrender the money, but also included the women that ordinarily would be excluded. But also let me mention that because MSACO also has the USSD aspect, so you do not have to use the internet. So there is the app, which requires internet, and that is, you know, for those that have smartphones. But because there is also the USSD feature, where the ordinary person using a very simple phone are able to actually transact. I think that the regulations, the National Payment Systems Act, and the respective regulations, which in a way, you know, you must give credit to Bank of Uganda, they have been very consultative in their approach to regulation. And really for that, we commend them, because they are new things, they are open to learning, they are able to discussions. And for me, I see this as a very important development in Uganda, but also in Africa. We've seen a number of other economies develop similar regulations. Zambia, where we also have operations, we see that as an important development for two reasons. One, it catalyzes, it accumulates the confidence of the population in the service of technology. Like I said before, it was very difficult. People just were apprehensive. They thought we were just linking with their circle account to actually steal their money. But with the regulation, you have now people becoming more confident. But also importantly, the regulation also opens up this sector to the investment community. Because the investors who are not on the ground would like to come and find a sector that is regulated, where someone, because the regulator takes care of certain aspects of governance, corporate governance. If you are not compliant with the laws, then you will not get a license. And if you continuously fault, then the license can be revoked. So an investor who is not on the ground uses regulation and compliance as a means of due diligence. And we are seeing, you know, now more discussions, warm discussions from investment community that are engaging different fintechs, and we feel that is really very welcome. Perhaps what the central bank, you know, needs to continue doing is to also recognize that other aspect of investment discussion, so that we have more people facilitated, you know, if they have asked for this kind of information, that the regulators are readily available to actually provide that information. They are doing this, but I think that they could even, you know, more intentionally continue to. I think that as a country, we have some very serious work, extremely serious work, as a country, Uganda, in terms of the investment engagement. Our neighbors in Kenya have really, really gone ahead in terms of developing the talent, that support the fintech industry. Developers, we do not have as much. The universities need to really skill up. They need to really change the curriculum, include, you know, business modeling, for example, because a developer coming from university needs to actually also understand, beyond just writing software, how does my software change lives? How does it impact lives? That is now something that is lacking with the kind of talent that the universities in Uganda are churning out. But also, the investment community in Uganda, we need to work, you know, with the regulators, but also the different associations, to see that the work that is here is brought to the stage, the global stage, so that it is seen and it can be supported.
So listening to Vicente's story, one thing is certainly for sure. Most of the people that have developed products for the different markets probably do it simply because maybe they just went through something and now sat down and said, you know what, we need to develop solutions that can help. It is important for you to create something out of experience, because then there is a bigger number of people that are probably going through the same thing that you have experienced. And when you generate this product, it will help them. And you can see from Vicente's story there, there's a bigger number of people now benefiting from a way back story that started with his family not being able to raise the school fees, despite the father selling the cow and the mother bringing all her savings on the table. They still wanted more money. Let's take a quick break. We'll see you shortly.